You know, for those of you who do not know me, my name is Ramesh Kumar, and I'm a pastor at Destiny C3. Actually, it's called Destiny C3. So C3 is basically a church from Australia, and we are still under the umbrella, but we are known as Destiny C3, and we're not known as, because they've got a few C3 churches here in KL. It's called there's one in Klang, it's called C3 Klang. There's one in KL called C3 KL. So the reason why our name is Destiny C3 is because C3 has one rule, and that is one church in one city, okay? But we have a few churches in one city, okay? So we decided to change the name to Destiny C3, but we still come under the covering of Destiny C3. So I've been in this church for a good 7 to 8 years, right? 7 to 8 years. And I've been serving the Lord. You know, I was born in Brunei. I grew up in Brunei. Of course, I'm still a Malaysian citizen. My parents are from Penang. And God has had his hand upon me since the day I was born. You know, I want to encourage some people here today. You know, I really feel in my heart that some people sitting here today are thinking, you know, to themselves, they're not sure whether they are in the right place. You know, they're not sure whether it's church or whether it's their careers, you know, whether it's their position with, you know, their families or whatever it is. You know, I really felt in my heart as we were worshiping that some people sitting here are very unsure whether they're in the right place, are very unsure whether God is with them, you know, and they're very unsure whether they're hearing the right things when they pray to God, as in God's leading. But I want to encourage you today that you know, as long as you are a child of God, God has a destiny for your life. Amen? He has a destiny for your life, and He's leading and guiding you. And the Bible says that, you know, He will lead us with His righteous right hand. You know, He will always lead us with His righteous right hand for His name's sake. Hallelujah. For His glory. Amen. So everything that is happening to you, your destiny, where you're journeying to, I want to tell you something. The road is never going to be easy. Hallelujah. It's never going to be easy. Just like Jesus Christ, when He sent Jesus Christ down to earth, you know, as we were talking about so much, you know, He had a destiny for Jesus. And of course, that destiny was to bring the Word of God on earth. And Jesus was to set that example, you know, even though He came in the form of flesh, He was to set that example that, you know, he can be holy as well. A man who was sinless, a man who knew no sin, who committed no sin. You know, He had a destiny. But despite the fact that He was sent by our Heavenly Father, as we sang the song, you know, He is forever holy. The God of our creation. The God who created everything. He's so powerful. The God who knows all, and He's all powerful. He's all knowing. He's always present everywhere. The destiny for Jesus wasn't easy. He still went through stuff. So I want to encourage you today, you know, if that's you and you're really unsure about where, you know, whether it is that you are in the right place, you know, whether it is that you're confident that God is leading you, I want to tell you something. God has His hand upon you. Hallelujah. He has His hand upon you. Do not overthink things, but walk by faith, not by sight. Hallelujah. Okay? Anyway, it's great to be back here at Seremban Life Assembly. I remember the last time I was here was 2019, if I'm not mistaken, right? It was 2019. And I'm a very familiar face in Seremban Life Assembly. I used to be invited here all the time. And we've had some good memories here. And I also did the youth camp before in Genting Highlands. It was in Genting Highlands, and we had a fantastic time. And talking about youth camp, I read a story about this pastor who actually conducted a youth camp. And at the youth camp, he spoke about practical Christian living. Okay, practical Christian living. And practical Christian living is something that is a necessity. You know, it's something that is routine. It's something that should happen day after day. Practical Christian living, okay? And one of the key elements of practical Christian living is considering God in everything. Okay, that's one of the key points of practical Christian living. But how many of us here actually consider God in everything that we do? Okay? Praise God. Not many hands. Don't worry. Very normal. Okay, it's very normal, you know. So I want to ask you a question. Do you consider God when you wake up in the morning? Do you consider God when you go to sleep? Do you consider God on your way to work? Wow, this is a safe church, I can say. When I preached this message in my church hall, everybody was quiet. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Yeah. Do you consider God when you make plans for your weekend? Do you consider God when you make plans for your future, for your careers, for your businesses? No, it's so important that we need to consider God in everything that we do. It's so vital. And the pastor at this particular youth camp, he asked this question to the youth. He said, "Where is God in your life?" And I want to tell you something. We live our lives like it's a bubble, okay? We live our lives like it's a bubble. And when we first start our life, that bubble is really small. Okay, it's a very small bubble, and it consists of very basic things, right? Most of the time, it consists of a mother and a father, perhaps a brother and a sister, if there are brothers and sisters, okay? And all that you care about during that time, that tiny bubble when you are first born, when you first come into this earth, is who's going to feed me, okay? Who's going to play with me? Who's going to comfort me? Who's going to carry me when I'm feeling fussy? Then as you continue to grow older and older and older, you know, that bubble gets bigger and bigger. And as that bubble gets bigger and bigger, you start to get more things. You start to meet more people. You start to buy a house. You start to buy a car. You start to have children. Hallelujah. Now, all of a sudden, that bubble is so huge, you know, it sometimes gets out of control. You know, when your bubble is small, it's easy to focus on one thing, right? But when your bubble gets bigger, you start splitting your focus on so many different things. Now, is that wrong? No. No. It's good to focus. It's good to split your focus on many different things. But the thing is, it's not good to focus on so many things without considering God first. You know, I want to share a story about my family. And, you know, as I mentioned, I was born in Brunei. So my parents were from Penang, and they migrated to Brunei during the 70s. And I was born there in Brunei. And so I lived in Brunei for a very long time, actually. But I remember at one stage of our lives, when I was, I think, right after primary six, you know, my parents had made plans to migrate to New Zealand, okay? And why did they want to make plans to migrate to New Zealand? Because the grass looked greener on the other side, okay? Okay, come on, it's everyone's dream, right? It's everyone's dream to migrate to a Western country, right? So, oh my God, Western country is so great, you know, it's like the air you breathe is so pure, right? Oh, such a, you know, balanced life you have there, you know, work. And it's true. It's true. I've lived in Western countries, and it's true that really the air is so much nicer than the air here in Malaysia, I can tell you that, you know. And it's a really good balance of, you know, work life and your personal life is a very good balance, you know. So we migrated there to New Zealand, and we stayed there for about 3 years. And I'll tell you, it was really tough. It was really tough. My mom was a teacher at that time, and she was being paid very well, because that time in New Zealand, they needed a lot of teachers, and teachers were paid really well, you know. But the thing about New Zealand is this, you know, once you get your salary and, you know, expenses, cost of living is high. And we lived in Auckland, you know, we lived in a big city. Cost of living was quite high. And after, you know, we would put money aside for all the expenses for the month, you know, then you had to pay your taxes. And let me tell you something, New Zealand, the taxes are really, really high. Really high. So it's like getting your paycheck and giving your paycheck back to the government. It seemed like that for 3 years. And so it was a struggle for us. And I remember at the age of 12, because my mom had to work for long hours and she couldn't come back in time to cook for us. You know, she used to always sometimes come back at about 8 o'clock at night, you know. She'll go in the morning, she comes back at 8 o'clock at night. So at the age of 12, I had to start to learn how to cook. Okay, I had to learn how to cook for the family, me and both my sisters. So me and my elder sister, we would cook and stuff like that. So it was pretty tough. And we as kids, you know, we were exposed to a new culture, you know, the Western culture. And so because of that, we started to also be misbehave la, in school and all that, la, you know. Like if you look at me, you see, wow, what a decent looking guy, man. I was a real rascal, la, okay, a real, real rascal. You can ask my parents la, if you ever meet them, you know. So my parents had a really, really tough time. So I remember there was one time, I think it was after a year, I had to return back to Brunei because what happened was when we left Brunei, my father stayed on because he was still under contract with the government in the hospital, right? My father is a pharmacist there. And he was supposed to come up a year after and to join us. But because I was misbehaving myself and all that, I had to go back la, because recommended by social welfare, it seems, of New Zealand that I had to return to go and stay with my father. So I went back to stay with my father, and we thought that after a year, when he finishes his contract, then we will go back to New Zealand. But it never happened. After a year, it just dragged on to another year. And then finally, my father said to me, your mom and your sisters are coming home. And I was like, oh, okay. They said, it's too difficult. So they came back. And when they came back, everybody had to reset. You know, 3 years, a lot of money was gone. A lot of money was owed to people, you know. And, you know, my mom had, she had to look for a job and all that. And so I remember when she came back, my parents, what they immediately did was they started considering God in that situation, okay? They started to seek the face of God. They started to seek God. They started to ask for direction. And I can tell you something that I found out from my mother many years later after she returned. I went up to her and I said, why did it not work out in New Zealand? And she told me, she was very honest, she said, it didn't work out because we never considered God when we wanted to make that move. We just wanted to do it. We left God out of the equation. And it was not God's will. So that's why we had to return. But anyway, going back to the story, you know, they started to seek God. They started to consider Him in everything, in their finances, in their career. And I want to tell you something. Not long after that, there was a breakthrough. My mom got a really good job in one of the local schools there. You know, she's a very highly educated, she's very highly educated in education. And so she got a really good job and the salary was really good. And within a year, they were able to settle all their debts.